Hey everyone, and welcome to my sort of comprehensive guide to everybody who is starting Fallout76 as a new player, or those who might have been playing for a while but they are still not really confident in their knowledge about the game. You know, the one-way stand is coming about, and we can expect at least a few people to join in, and hopefully this guide will be helping them to start anew in a relatively good understanding of how the game works and what they should be paying attention to. Alright, to start things off with, I want to talk about inventory management, because it's gonna be one of the biggest hurdles that you need to keep in mind when it comes to general gameplay. Let's go over every single tab in the items section, which is gonna be important for your inventory, one by one, and just let me give you a few general tips. If you're a new player, then you need to pick up pretty much every single weapon that you find. Why? Because if you scrap them, then it's gonna earn you mods. Mods, of course, are attachments that you can see right here, that gonna get unlocked either by learning certain plans, which is usually for the rarer ones, or just scrapping a bunch of the said weapon. Like if I were to say scrap a bunch of Urasa Gatling lasers, I would unlock available mods for certain parts, and then at the workbench I can actually add those parts onto them in exchange for certain materials that you pick up. That's why you need to scrap a bunch of those weapons. If you don't know how many of you have already unlocked the actual workbenches that you can craft the weapons at, it will tell you how much you already have unlocked, and then if you see that there are, I don't know, 32 out of 41 mods, then you can still earn a few more. Or if it's no longer giving you any mods despite having scrapped like 20 or 30, then it's probably one of those mods that you can only learn by learning plans, which will come later. As for apparel, it's pretty much the same deal. However, the rate at which you learn apparel modifications is much, much, much slower. Like, for example, usually every single weapon will give you at least one mod unlocks for like the first, I don't know, 5 or 6 scrapping, depending on how many mods the weapon has. But for an armor, you usually need to scrap at least 5 or even sometimes 10 just to unlock a single mod. And armors do have quite a few mods themselves. There's usually a mod that can increase its damage and energy resistance. And there is one that adds a few or a certain sort of bonus effect to it, kind of like a legendary, but it's a bit different. Paints are not unlocked, by the way, by scrapping. You can only get those are kind of the cosmetic options that you can get for premium money. Again, just scrap them all if you are not using certain ones. That will help you get the plans as early as you can. Aid items, I usually use this general rule that I never really carry around more than 15 purified water, 20 Red Away and 20 Steam Packs. I know that this is more than I said so, but I'm gonna sell the excess ones, because actually Steam Packs, Red Away and 3-5 Water does earn you quite a bit of money for how easy it is to come by them. As for other stuff like, you know, meat, vegetables and whatnot to decrease your hunger level, I just, you know, advise of picking up pretty much anything that you can, as long as it doesn't go overboard with the weight. Like, for example, you know, this is a weighting 1, so I definitely wouldn't pick up more than 10 of the canned meat stew. Misc is a kind of interesting tab in the way that there is not much here that actually weighs stuff, but there is still a few. For example, the repair kits, the legendary modules, nuclear key cards, and the gunpowder, as well as ores. And there are certain cores that you can pick up in missions, but like for example the missile silo runs, but this is kind of specific, so you don't really need to worry about that for now. However, gunpowder is something that adds up really easily. As you can see, it actually weighs 0.05, which is doesn't seem much, but you know, since you probably get about 5 for every single super mutant that you kill, it actually can rack up quite easily. This is actually after that I've used up most of them for crafting, and I shouldn't be carrying this about. You can just store it in your stash box. Hollow doesn't really have any weight whatsoever, so you don't really care about that. Notes does have weight, however. It's 1/4 of a pound for every single note. They all weigh the same. And just to quickly mention that the price here, the value of a note, doesn't signify how important that is. Marine Tactical Helmet is one of the best plans to have, because you can learn a very cool looking helmet, not only that, but that helmet can be sold for a very high price for how easy it is to craft and how light it is to carry about. So this is actually, even if you craft, even if you ask anybody on the market, will net you much, much value than, for example, something like even a flamer, which is actually, you know, valued at much, much higher price, only because this is actually something that is sort of a more complicated item to craft, like a weapon or something like a T60 helm, again, is something like an armor part. Junk is something that you need to keep constant check on, because every single time you go to a workbench, you need to use a tab here with an scrap all junk. And once you get that scrapped, you know, everything down to their base components, then you can store it in your stash box, which you should also do quite regularly. My recommendation is to never carry around junk on your person, because junk can be taken off from your stash box when it comes to crafting. So even if you don't have it on your person when you need to, for example, craft an armor piece or a weapon, it will still use up the junk that you have in your stash. But on the other hand, you can lose the junk by dying, which of course definitely isn't something that you want. That's why it's just worth keeping in your stash. Mods is a bit uninteresting again, but I can give you the advice that pick up every single one of the power armor mods that you find. You know, the T45, 51, 60, Excavator, X01, because those mods not only can worth quite a bit of caps if you sell it at the vendors, but they often can be more rare than you would think. Because, for example, the calibrated shock mods are one of the most valuable ones, or the emergency protocols ones. And they also yield you kind of nice junk if you scrap them, like fiberglass and whatnot. Ammunition is one of the most overlooked and yet most important tabs here. As you can see, there is a bunch of different ammunition that I have here, and I don't even use half of these. And I'm a bad example because I usually just hoard them to give it to my other characters. But if you don't have more than one character, there's literally no reason for you to keep them, because you cannot sell them to vendors, and other players usually don't really care about them unless it's a 5.56 or a 45 ammunition. There are of course examples, but that's just the two most frequently requested ammunition types. I recommend, you know, just keeping the few ones that you have for your weapons, because even though you might miss on a few as you go in your first 40 or 50 levels, it's gonna be pretty easy to get them again by the time you get there, because you're gonna be unlocking perks that will let you craft ammunition much easier. Okay, now that we have went over the inventory management system, let's go over to your sort of first aims when it comes to jumping into the game. Alright, let's talk about your necessary gear. As a general consensus, the weapon and apparel doesn't really matter until you reach level 40 or 50, because at that point you're gonna be receiving the kind of max level weapons and armor that you will be using for the long term of the game anyway, and it's unlikely that you will get a god roll of any sort of weapon or armor by the time you reach that level anyway, because it's kind of short. Like, the first 40 or 50 levels of your gameplay is gonna be very easy to reach. After that, it's gonna get exponentially harder, of course, especially after level 100, but again, as a general idea, don't worry about your gear up until you reach level 50 or 40. If you want to worry about something, then you should worry about the weapons, and worry about them in the sense that you need to figure out what sort of weapon types you like using. Do you prefer just, you know, single-shot, high-damage weapons? Then you probably want to go for snipers. Do you don't really want to miss stuff, but you like fighting up close, you probably want to go for shotguns. If you don't want to miss at all, then you should probably use tactical rifles, because that's a crutch, but that's a topic for a different day. And again, just, you know, try to figure out what weapons suit your playstyle. And at the same time, I'm gonna link this page, by the way, in the description, but there is a certain web page where you can actually plan out your perks, which is gonna be coming up next, the perk points. Perks work in a sort of, how should I say, allowance way. You first, of course, need to select your certain special stats, and depending on how many special stats you have in a certain tree, that's how many perk cards you can equip into the tree. As you can see, I have 12 here, so I can equip 4 3-pointer cards, or, you know, 12 1-pointers, and so on and so on. There is no restrictions of amount of cards you can equip here, but the amount of points that the card require is limited by your special stats. And the special stats themselves don't only just allow you to put in perk points, or perk cards rather, but they also give you certain stats. Strength gives you melee weapon damage and carry weight. Perception gives you VATS hit chance and enemy sort of notification marker pop-ups. Endurance gives you health and sprinting, not distance, but sort of AP drain reduction. So, you know, the bigger your endurance, the slower your AP will gonna drain. Charisma increases your the amount you can sell for vendors for caps. And also, of course, how many perk cards you can share, divided by 3. So since I have 6 charisma, I can share 2 points worth of perk card. But that can only be 1 card, by the way, so I cannot share 2 1-pointers. I can only share 1 2-pointer or 1 1-pointer. Intelligence gives you amount of experience gained. agility increases your AP itself, so not the amount it drains by using it up, but rather how much overall AP you have. And luck it increases the rate at which your critical meter fills, which is not going to be that useful for certain weapon styles, but it's still overall nice stat to have high because there is a bunch of good perk cards in luck tree. Other than that, I can't really say much more about the perk cards without going into way too much detail. What I would like to say is that shotguns, heavy weapons, and all the melee weapons are in strength 3. Perception has the bows, rifles, and auto rifles. Agility has the pistols and the automatic pistols, and intelligence has the explosives. So this is what you need to keep in mind. I can usually spec my characters to use at least two types of weapons, even though I'm definitely not min-maxing those weapon types, but it's more than enough to have a comfortable playstyle and enough of a weapon choice for you to enjoy the game. Other than that, I think the main perk points or perk cards that you should need to keep in mind are the gunsmith and the other variant of it, which is of course the makeshift warrior. Unless you either don't use weapons at all or you don't use melee weapons at all, makeshift warrior is needed for crafting and maintaining your melee weapons, while gunsmith is used to maintaining your weapons and upgrading them. You're gonna need those to actually equip them with certain parts. But even if you don't do that, then the 50% slower breaking time, or rather degradation time, is really, really handy. Action Girl is a sort of jack-of-all-trades sort of card, because it's going to be useful for using vets, sprinting, jumping, and so on and so on. Other than that, Bloody Mess is a must-have for most characters, because it just gives you a flat increase of damage for only 3 perk points, and this actually applies to all the weapon damage that you do. And if you are going to be using mutations, which most people do at this point, Class Freak and Stars Genes are very, very useful to have as well. Other than that, it's basically down to your build. Now, the way you want to progress in this game is, of course, at the very beginning to follow missions. Not only because the two main missions of the game require both for you to sort of progress in the main storyline, at least up until the point where you reach the AVR Medical Center, which will get you inoculated against the Scourge disease. Not gonna talk about what that is for now, but you should go up until that point at the very least with the main story. Other than that, definitely take a detour to Morgantown Airport as one of the missions not only gonna bring you there, but you're gonna get the plans for a small backpack, which is very, very easy to pick up, and it will give you an extra 30 carry weight if you are at max level, but it's gonna be ranking up to that, so at the very beginning it's only gonna give you like 5, but it's gonna get higher and higher as you reach higher and higher levels. You just need to craft the backpack every single time you reach a certain new level. Other than that, there are again few more storylines. One of them starts at the Wayward, one of them is gonna start at the Overseer's home here at Sutton, but that's only gonna work out if you are level 20 and you have yourself inoculated at the AVR Medical Center with the other quest line. And there's gonna be some other stuff down at the Mire and around the abandoned waste dump, but that's again a bit spoilery. And there is not really, like a certain point at which you need to focus your mind on. I feel like exploring the map is part of the fun that 76 is, but these are just certain important locations that you need to check out as a must, so to speak. And of course, never forget that these things, that the events with the big exclamation mark, are events that you can not only fast travel to for free. There is no join event cost here, unlike if I were to fast travel here, which is gonna give cost me 5 caps. But these are gonna probably give you good loot, and there are gonna be other people participating to help you out as well. And the experience that they give you is nothing to sneeze at either, which is very, very good to not only discover some new locations easily on the map, but level you up quickly. And last but not least, of course, the camp, which is gonna also connected to the map. You need to set it up to a certain location where you think you would usually go back to often, because fast traveling to your camp is free, as you can see. And the camp will give you your stash box, which you can drop down your junk to, which of course isn't the only stash box in the game. There are always stash boxes at a train stations, which are marked like this, or at Red Rocket stations, which are not marked on your map, but every single major location, like Flatwoods, Lewis' work has one, I think, or maybe it was Welch. Every single bigger location has one of those. So it's not really that hard to come by stash boxes, but you still need to keep in mind, and having your camp in a location which usually makes you go past by a lot is really, really handy to have along the ride as well. And yes, that's pretty much all about your kind of starting of the game. Fighting and whatnot, you know, just battling is an entirely different topic to handle, but it's definitely something that's very easy to figure out, you know, accustomed to easier than anything else that I've said so far. Alright, hopefully this was informative and helpful for your first playthrough, or just jumping into the game, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye, guys.